Welcome to A Year of War and Peace. I'm your host, Brian E. Denton. A Year of War and Peace is a daily, year-long, chapter-by-chapter reading of and meditation on Leo Tolstoy's epic novel, War and Peace. In these videos and podcasts, you'll be treated to a free reading of one chapter per day of the novel, plus a reflective essay I've written individually tailored to that day's chapter. These readings are offered for free, though if you'd like to support me, you can do so in one of three ways. First, you could purchase my ebook, A Year of War and Peace. It features the entire novel, plus all of my reflective essays, and it's only $2.99 on Amazon.com. You could also become a patron at patreon.com/BrianEDenton. If you sign up there, you'll receive a sonnet once a month, plus a link to an ebook of my collected sonnets. Finally, if you like, you can make a one-time donation to my PayPal account. The email there is briandenton@gmail.com. You can also use that email to contact me. I'd be happy to hear from you. Your support is greatly appreciated. Today's reading and reflection is on chapter 110. Chapter 110. Again, Pierre was overtaken by the depression he so dreaded. For 3 days after the delivery of his speech at the lodge, he lay on a sofa at home, receiving no one and going nowhere. It was just then that he received a letter from his wife, who implored him to see her, telling him how grieved she was about him, and how she wished to devote her whole life to him. At the end of the letter, she informed him that in a few days she would return to Petersburg from abroad. Following this letter, one of the Masonic brothers, whom Pierre respected less than the others, forced his way in to see him, and turning the conversation upon Pierre's matrimonial affairs, by way of fraternal advice, expressed the opinion that his severity to his wife was wrong, and that he was neglecting one of the first rules of Freemasonry by not forgiving the penitent. At the same time, his mother-in-law, Prince Vasily's wife, sent to him imploring him to come, if only for a few minutes, to discuss a most important matter. Pierre saw that there was a conspiracy against him, and that they wanted to reunite him with his wife, and in the mood he then was in, this was not even unpleasant to him. Nothing mattered to him. Nothing in life seemed to him of much importance, and under the influence of the depression that possessed him, he valued neither his liberty nor his resolution to punish his wife. No one is right, no one is to blame. So she too is not to blame, he thought. If he did not at once give his consent to a reunion with his wife, it was only because, in his state of depression, he did not feel able to take any step. Had his wife come to him, he would not have turned her away. Compared to what preoccupied him, was it not a matter of indifference whether he lived with his wife or not? Without replying either to his wife or his mother-in-law, Pierre late one night prepared for a journey and started for Moscow to see Joseph Alexeyevich. This is what he noted in his diary. Moscow, 17th November. I have just returned from my benefactor and hasten to write down what I have experienced. Joseph Alexeyevich is living poorly and has for 3 years been suffering from a painful disease of the bladder. No one has ever heard him utter a groan or a word of complaint. From morning to late at night, except when he eats his very plain food, he is working at science. He received me graciously and made me sit down on the bed on which he lay. I made the sign of the Knights of the East and of Jerusalem, and he responded in the same manner, asking me with a mild smile what I had learned and gained in the Prussian and Scottish lodges. I told him everything as best I could, and told him that I had proposed to our Petersburg lodge of the bad reception I had encountered, and of my rupture with the brothers. Joseph Alexeyevich, having remained silent and thoughtful for a good while, told me his view of the matter, which at once lit up for me my whole past and the future path I must follow. He surprised me by asking whether I remembered the threefold aim of the order. 1. The preservation and study of the mystery. 2. The purification and reformation of oneself for its reception. And 3. The improvement of the human race by striving for such purification. Which is the principal aim of these three? Certainly self-reformation and self-purification. Only to this aim can we always strive independently of circumstances. But at the same time, just this aim demands the greatest efforts of us, and so, led astray by pride, losing sight of this aim, we occupy ourselves with either the mystery which in our impurity we are unworthy to receive, or seek the reformation of the human race, while ourselves setting an example of baseness and profligacy. Illuminism is not a pure doctrine, just because it is attracted by social activity and puffed up by pride. On this ground, Joseph Alexievich condemned my speech and my whole activity, and in the depths of my soul I agreed with him. Talking of my family affairs, he said to me, "The chief duty of a true Mason, as I have told you, lies in perfecting himself. We often think that by removing all the difficulties of our life, we shall more quickly reach our aim. But on the contrary, my dear sir, it is only in the midst of worldly cares that we can attain our chief three aims. 1. Self-knowledge, for any man can know himself by comparison. 2. Self-perfecting, which can only be attained by conflict. And 3. The attainment of the chief virtue, love of death. Only the vicissitudes of life can show us its vanity and develop our innate love of death or of rebirth to a new life." These words are all the more remarkable because in spite of his great physical suffering, Joseph Alexievich is never weary of life, though he loves death, for which, in spite of the purity and loftiness of his inner man, he does not yet feel himself sufficiently prepared. My benefactor then explained to me fully the meaning of the great square of creation, and pointed out to me that the numbers 3 and 7 are the basis of everything. He advised me not to avoid intercourse with the Petersburg brothers, but to take up only second-grade posts in the lodge, to try, while diverting the brothers from pride, to turn them toward the true path of self-knowledge and self-perfecting. Besides this, he advised me for myself personally, above all, to keep a watch over myself. And to that end, he gave me a notebook, the one I am now writing in, and in which I will in future note down all my actions. Petersburg, 23rd November. I am again living with my wife. My mother-in-law came to me in tears and said that Helene was here and that she implored me to hear her, that she was innocent and unhappy at my desertion, and much more. I knew that if I once let myself see her, I should not have the strength to go on refusing what she wanted. In my perplexity, I did not know whose aid and advice to seek. Had my benefactor been here, he would have told me what to do. I went to my room and reread Joseph Alexievich's letters, and recalled my conversations with him, and deduced from it all that I ought not to refuse a supplicant, and not to reach a helping hand to everyone, especially to one so closely bound to me, and that I must bear my cross. But if I forgive her for the sake of doing right, then let union with her have only a spiritual aim. That is what I decided, and what I wrote to Joseph Alexievich. I told my wife that I begged her to forget the past, to forgive me whatever wrong I may have done her, and that I had nothing to forgive. It gave me joy to tell her this. She need not know how hard it was for me to see her again. I have settled on the upper floor of this big house, and am experiencing a happy feeling of regeneration. All right, that concludes my reading of chapter 110. I'll now proceed to my reflection on the same. A Year of War and Peace, Day 110. The Purification and Reformation of Oneself. Pierre is in a funk. If it was the 21st century, he'd be couch-bound, eating tubs of Haagen-Dazs and binge-watching The Office on Netflix. Given that it's only the 19th century, however, he'll have to settle for being couch-bound, depressed, and entertained only by correspondence letters. The first of these letters is from his wife, Helene. She reports that she shall soon return from abroad to Petersburg, and that she's worried about him. She wants to see him again. She misses him dearly, and wants only to return to him so that she may devote her whole life to him. All this is to say, of course, that she has probably run out of his money. He also receives a letter from a Masonic brother imploring him to forgive his wife. Curiously, a third letter arrives, this time from Pierre's mother-in-law, also about Helene. Surely, Pierre suspects, some conspiracy is afoot. Well, at least this gets him to his feet again and out of the house. He goes to his Masonic mentor, Joseph Alexievich Bazdiev. There he finds the old man in intolerable pain, but uncomplaining. The two talk about the tenets of the order, and Alexievich teaches Pierre that of the threefold aim of the order, the most important is the purification and reformation of oneself. He then provides Pierre with a notebook, so he can use it to engage in reflective self-examination. This is something we've counseled here at A Year of War and Peace. After a bit of this self-examination, Pierre decides that he must forgive and return to his wife, though he does so only spiritually. Something happens. Once he is reunited with her, despite all the pain she has caused him, Pierre experiences a, quote, happy feeling of regeneration, end quote. Perhaps this feeling is due to his philosophical practice of taking daily account of reflective self-examination and the truths he finds therein. Daily meditation. When then we are doing anything not rightly from this day, we shall impute it to nothing else than to the will from which we have done it. And it is that which we shall endeavor to take away and to extirpate more than the tumors and abscesses out of the body. And in like manner, we shall give the same account of the cause of the things which we do right. And we shall no longer allege as causes of any evil to us, either slave or neighbor or wife or children, being persuaded that if we do not think things to be what we do think them to be, we do not the acts which follow from such opinions. And as to thinking or not thinking, that is in our power, and not in externals. Epictetus, The Discourses. All right, so that concludes my reading and reflection on chapter 110. I hope you liked it. Thanks so much for listening. Remember that if you'd like to support me, you can do so either by purchasing the ebook, A Year of War and Peace, becoming a patron at patreon.com, or making a one-time donation to PayPal. The links to all that are below. Your support is greatly appreciated. Tomorrow we will be reading and reflecting on chapter 111. I hope you'll join me. Until then, take care of yourselves and others.